Start today's class. Actually, today's class is a slight deviation from what we discussed in the previous class. We are continuing the topic of studying reactions in organometallic chemistry. And if you remember, I told you that there can be insertions into molecules other than carbonyl. So a very classic, just a moment. A very classic example of an insertion reaction is this reaction where the R group migrates onto the carbon and so generates acyl moiety. But I said that insertions of neutral molecules, or I shouldn't say insertions, migratory insertions of one electron ligands onto neutral molecules can happen. So we looked at migrations into acetylenes, alkynes, and I think we also looked at carbenes. So all those examples. And in the last class, I in fact touched upon chloropalladation reaction, which led to palladium chloride cyclizing three acetylene molecules, R, C, triple bond, C, R, to generate a arene moiety. Okay, so this is something that we looked at. This is something that we looked at in the last class. And sorry about this disturbance that is there. So today I'm going to deviate from that, and I want to tell you that there is an example where you can have such cyclizations, but those cyclizations are not proceeding through insertion reactions, but these reactions are actually proceeding through a coupling reaction. The coupling reaction is a reaction which leads to a temporary oxidation of the metal. So in other words, imagine the scenario, this is just representative. Imagine the scenario where you have two neutral ligands. Okay, I have two neutral ligands. And in those two neutral ligands, if I have a coupling, ligand coupling, so that I form a bond between these two ligands, I make both of them one electron ligands. Now these have become one electron ligands. This is also one electron ligand. And a carbon-carbon bond, not necessarily a carbon-carbon bond, but an element-element bond has been formed in between the two ligands. This leads to an intermediate that has the metal in a plus 2 oxidation state. Suppose the oxidation state was N, this oxidation state is N plus 2. And subsequently, the N plus 2 oxidation state species, which is here, the second step I've written, does a second carbon-carbon or an element-element bond formation and a breaking of the bond which is there here. Okay, this results in the formation of metal in the oxidation state N and the release of a ligand, a new species. You started with L, now you have ended up with L2. This type of a coupling reaction is very common. you don't know what has happened because this whole thing is happening in the catalytic sphere of this metal in N oxidation state. N can be zero, N can be anything, plus one, etc. So this is happening in a catalytic fashion, and you have coupled two ligands. These reactions are common, and we will talk about those reactions today. So I'm talking about ligand coupling reactions where a temporary oxidation of the metal has happened. I'm calling them ligand coupling reactions in this slide, but I will also refer to them as oxidative coupling. Okay. Let me briefly go back to the previous class where we talked about an insertion reaction which leads to coupling. The insertion reaction was the insertion of a chloro ligand. So you remember palladium chloride with acetylene, depending on the size of the R group present on the alkyne, can become a arene, it can become a cyclobutadiene. And when R is very bulky, it turns out to be a system where only the alkyne is coordinated to the metal. Nothing has happened really. It's just coordination of the alkyne to the metal. So you know that this is the first step in the reaction. And it is most likely that the second step in the reaction is the formation of the cyclobutadiene complex. But the cyclobutadiene complex could have another intermediate, and that intermediate was characterized by some people. I forget the name I mentioned in the last class. So this was discovered as an intermediate which had such a character. Okay, I am not writing the substituents, but notice the oxidation state of palladium remains at plus two. You just done an insertion reaction. In insertion reaction, the oxidation state never changes. You just move the ligands around in such a way that a new ligand is formed. So here you have changed from a chloride ligand to a vinyl ligand. Okay, and the oxidation state of the palladium remains at plus two. So this is the palladium in plus two, and here also palladium is in plus two oxidation state. And here in every step of the reaction, you have plus two as the oxidation state. And if the second step, if in the second step, suppose you do a chloropalladation, you move the chlorine to one of the carbons and you form a new palladium carbon bond. So you form this intermediate. You have, instead of, remember you are very familiar with the beta hydride elimination. I can do a beta chloro elimination in this case, and the reaction would go right back to the previous step. So insertion reactions, I emphasized this in the previous class also, insertion reactions and beta hydride elimination reactions are just reverse reactions, or they just reactions which are identical. One is the insertion reaction is a forward reaction, and the backward reaction is a beta hydride elimination reaction, or in this case the beta chloro elimination. And this will give you right the starting material back. So oxidation state doesn't change. And if you do a vinyl insertion into another this is a vinyl group now. This vinyl group can insert into another alkyne and produce another intermediate, which is also a vinyl compound. Now also the oxidation state is plus two. And this, after rotation around this bond, formed this intermediate which could do now a delta elimination. Instead of a beta, you just have the delta position, the chloride in the delta position, and it is going back. The delta chloro elimination is what is resulting in this cyclobutadiene complex. I had not emphasized this in the previous class, so I just wanted to tell you this. What, and also I did not emphasize the fact that if you take cyclobutadiene complexes of this type, you do not generate arenes quickly. Okay, so you do not generate this arene easily. So this seems to be a dead end. If that elimination happens, if the delta elimination happens, this is a end product of the molecule. So species which lead to the formation of arenes must be going from this step by addition of another alkyne. And in fact, that is indeed the case. Zeta, so I would put the next insertion reaction, and that's the next insertion reaction. Now we have hexatriene molecule. This hexatriene molecule and a zeta elimination gives you the arene and back to palladium chloride. Oxidation state has not changed at all. So that's the reason why I'm calling this by another mechanism. I'm calling this oxidative coupling mechanism. And I will tell you, I will talk about this reaction in detail today. Okay. So let me now introduce to you, in the previous case, I talked about palladium. So as chemists, we often turn to the periodic table. We look at the periodic table and say, okay, I have a metal which is in group 10, nickel, group 10. That's the new nomenclature, group 10 nickel. And the nickel and the palladium chloride is doing this. So nickel chloride should also be capable of doing acetylene couplings. That's true. Nickel does coupling reactions, but in nickel couples four acetylenes together and forms cyclooctatetraene. In fact, there is no easy method of preparing cyclooctatetraene except through this method. And nickel acac, which is nickel plus two, is supposed to be the best catalyst for forming cyclooctatetraene. So this molecule is fondly called by chemists as COT, octatetraene. It is in fact a tub-shaped molecule. Here you go. This is a tub-shaped molecule. And this is done only by nickel 2 plus. Now, it's tempting for us to suggest the same type of a reaction mechanism. Acetylenes to arenes to cyclobutadiene, polyacetylenes, etc. The best catalyst must be a nickel group, and it must be doing it through insertion reactions. Unfortunately, the best way to make arene was, we told you about the palladium group, but the most efficient is in fact cobalt. It's not nickel, it's not platinum, it is cobalt. Okay, and the best catalyst for arene for cyclization is CpCOCO2. We'll talk about it in a few minutes, but this particular reaction that the palladium chloride can stitch acetylenes together, and the way in which cobalt couples acetylenes together proceeds by very different mechanisms. And that is the topic of today's lecture. So coupling with insertion and coupling with stitching with insertion and stitching with coupling. Okay, so those are the two things. Now I have put for you the reaction cycle immediately. In fact, I wanted to draw it out for you. The molecule that we have is CpCOCO2. This is the structure of the molecule. It's a piano stool with two legs. Now you can readily imagine the loss of carbon monoxide and the substitution of an acetylene molecule. I'm going to draw both of them, but obviously this would have happened through two steps. So here you go. This is the now you have a person on skis, if you might call it. It's not a piano stool, it's there are two skis that are present on the cobalt atom. And you can understand, this is cobalt 1, by the way, oxidation state 1. This is also cobalt 1. Now, if this cobalt has got some extra electrons sitting on its d manifold, you can do a cyclization reaction in which you would move the electrons around. You can move the electrons around. If you want to do it like this, you can do it like this, resulting in the formation of a cobalt 3 complex now. This is now a cobalt 3 complex. This is cobalt 3 by definition. And this intermediate, if it adds on one more acetylene, it can form a this is a metallocyclopentadiene. And this would be a metallocycloheptatriene. It's a 7-membered ring. So you have a metallocycloheptatriene. This can do a carbon-carbon bond formation. Let me just indicate that for you in a separate color so that you can visualize it. And back again to the cobalt plus plus the benzene ring that you have. So in fact, I should have put those let's make it Me6 to be realistic. So let's assume that you have dimethyl acetylene and it has become hexamethyl benzene. So this is a species which can readily react with another two molecules of acetylene and form this intermediate, which goes through this cycle. Notice how you've gone from cobalt 1 to cobalt 3 and then back to cobalt 1 to form this benzene ring. So this is the mechanism that we are proposing, and this is because several reactions have been done which have shown that these steps are in fact reasonable. The first and foremost reason is the fact that if you add carbon monoxide, the reaction is stopped. Carbon monoxide is a poison. carbon monoxide is a poison for this reaction. If I add some carbon monoxide, the first step is stopped. So in other words, it just blocks the reaction. It removes the catalytically active species, which is this species which we will put it in green. This is the catalytically active species. That species is removed if you add a lot of carbon monoxide. Carbon monoxide is a poison. So the first step is dissociation of carbon monoxide. Association of acetylene doesn't require many proofs, but there are complexes where you have cobalt coordinated to two acetylene molecules, the way in which I've written on the screen. So if I label this as A, A is known as precedence for that is there. Okay. Now the only thing that remains to be seen is how will this second step work? The second step, if we can, okay, before we go to the second step, can we show that an intermediate like this is involved? And that seems to be yes. If I add PME3, this intermediate is trapped. And it can be characterized. So B has been shown as an intermediate that can be trapped. And what is interesting is that if I can somehow now remove the PME3, this becomes again a catalytically active intermediate. So that is an essential, if I add something like PPH3, then the reaction is reversible, and I can remove PPH3 using some other what are called ligand sponges, and then that can push the reaction forward, and again it becomes catalytically active. So there is proof for the first step, there is proof for A, there is a proof for B, and now the question is, how will the next step go? I have written it as if it goes through a metallocycloheptatriene. Let's label that as C. So is there proof for C? There is no direct proof for C, but I will now show you how I can proceed from B to the product D. Okay, how I can go all the way from B to D. Let me go forward to the next slide. Pretty much what I have told you is listed everywhere in this slide. But the only thing I want to tell you is that, yes, I made one error, and that was the L is PPH3. Okay, L is PPH3 in the first step, not CO. Whatever I said holds true. What the experiment that people did was this, but it is known that CO is a poison. Okay, now I have said that there is some evidence that this in fact could be the intermediate. I will come to this a bit later, but first I'm going to tell you that there is an alternative mechanism for this whole process, and that is if I use this is a diene, And imagine that you have a dienophile. A dienophile is something that will react. Usually a dienophile is electron deficient. So if I have diethyl acetylene dicarboxylate, DED, or DMAD, dimethyl acetylene dicarboxylate. These are very electron deficient acetylenes and they're extremely good dienophiles. So if I have a dienophile, the dienophile can react with this metallocyclopentadiene. It's not a simple cyclopentadiene, it's a metallocyclopentadiene. It can react with it intermediate like this. So I hope you're able to follow. The formation of this is a Diels-Alder reaction. So a Diels-Alder reaction with a very good dienophile and this metallocyclopentadiene can lead to an intermediate like this. This can then eliminate the cobalt and it will generate the identical species CpCO. So this is not going to be any different. This is going to be the same species which would be formed if you formed if you carried out a Diels-Alder reaction and then elimination of the catalytically active intermediate, it will again generate a benzene ring. Now, dimethyl ethylene dicarboxylate will result in the derivative of phthalic acid, diethyl phthalate, that's what you'll get. And it turns out that both reactions are feasible. You can tilt the reaction to go in one side or the other. I told you in the previous slide that PME3 blocks the reaction and you can isolate this. You can take this and do a Diels-Alder adduct and derivatize the species. Okay, so you can do a Diels-Alder reaction on this species with reactive dienophiles, and if you heat them, then you do end up with arene substituted arenes. So it turns out that there is some evidence that this reaction can also proceed like this. I will give you that evidence as we progress. So basically, what this slide, this is referring to this. This is if you you can block the reaction with PME3, then the reaction stops. Okay, so that's the blocking reaction that has been carried out. Okay, so if I do not have something to block, and it is probable that the reaction goes through a Diels-Alder reaction, through a Diels-Alder intermediate, or it goes through a metallocycloheptatriene. Right now, we have not given you enough evidence for metalloheptatriene, but I'm going to give you a reaction where Diels-Alder does not work. So that's a kind of a negative evidence. It's not positive evidence, but it's negative evidence. Okay. So what is interesting in this reaction is that the first step is extremely fast. So instead of acetylene, in the metallocycloheptadiene formation is very fast. And if I have a nitrile RC triple bond N, I end up forming pyridines. Okay, so this is a very interesting reaction that was exploited by a person called KPC Olhut. You probably have heard of him if you are an organic chemist. He did several interesting natural product synthesis using this reaction, and this was with I think we have a couple of faculty members who have interacted with KPC Olhut, and this is the way in which he exploited this reaction. So substituted pyridines would be difficult to make by other means. This turns out to be a very simple method to make it. One more alternative in this whole reaction cycle is to is to use a mixture of acetylenes and alkenes. If you use one acetylene and one alkene, it turns out that a mixture of products will be formed. It's not going to be a clean reaction, but nevertheless, you can adjust the pressure of ethylene in such a way that it will compensate for the poorer reactivity of ethylene, and you will end up with, now you will end up with an intermediate where you have acetylene and alkene on the cobalt. That will form, instead of a metallocyclopentadiene, it will form a metallocyclopentene, right? It will form a metallocyclopentene. This metallocyclopentene can either react with another ethylene or an acetylene. Like I said, by controlling the pressure of ethylene versus acetylene, you can bias the reaction to go in one direction or the other. So if it forms a reaction with it, if it reacts with another acetylene, which is shown on the right side of the screen, you will end up with a cyclohexadiene, which is 1,2 substituted. And if you can generate, if you can react it with another olefin, then you can end up with a cycloheptametallocycloheptene. Okay, so that's also possible. And if I now do a beta hydride elimination, now I do a beta hydride elimination with or a beta hydride migration, I can end up with this species. I think I might have written it down in, no, I have not written it down. I will write it down later. I don't want to complicate it here. So I do a hydrogen migration that results in this particular compound. Okay. So a third example is the Poisson-Kahn reaction. So these are very popular reactions. Poisson-Kahn reaction also involves acetylene and an alkene, but this time the third molecule is carbon monoxide. So you have three species. All three species are combined together to form this, and the catalyst of choice is CO2CO8. You can write it on a mononuclear cobalt complex, but it's also likely that this whole reaction proceeds with a dinuclear intermediate. It's not impossible, but what you end up with is the acetylene is something that is here, and your alkene are these two carbons, and your carbon monoxide, for good measure, we will make that also colored. So there you go. Three different species stitched together. That's the Poisson-Kahn reaction. It turns out to be reasonably effective. And in one step, you can stitch together three molecules, something that you cannot do with other systems. So this is a real triumph of organometallic catalysis. So this turns out to be a reasonably good way of making these molecules. Okay, so in all these cases, the intermediate was a plus 2 oxidation state. You start with M in plus N oxidation state, or N equals 0, and you oxidize it along with coupling. You oxidize it to plus 2, and then you reduce it back to the initial oxidation state. Surprisingly, a variety of metals can do it. It is not just cobalt which does it efficiently. Cobalt is a metal which is a metal of choice when it comes to Poisson-Kahn reaction, for example. This is a mistake. This should be cobalt. Okay, so what Coleman, I have taken this Coleman is the same person who is the author of the book Coleman and Hegedus, or Norton, Coleman and Hegedus. Those are the three people who wrote the organometallic, organotransition metal chemistry, which is a very good book, but very expensive. And Coleman studied a lot of reactions, and I'm going to take a few reactions which he has studied, and those deal with iridium and rhodium. Okay, again, catalysts which you are very familiar with, but it's belonging to the same cobalt family. All these molecules proceed through oxidative coupling reactions. They are not proceeding through insertion reactions that palladium does. Okay, and interestingly, in his paper, the first this is a review, kind of a mini review, I think. He talks about how iron, all these species, iron, titanium, zirconium, cobalt, which is pictured here, all of them are capable of doing this cyclotrimerization of acetylenes, and they do it through this coupling. In addition, he also says that metallocyclopentadiene, that is this species which is present here, okay, the species which is present here is a very common intermediate and seems to be involved in acetylene trimerization reactions. Okay, now this is directly from his paper. I just wanted to emphasize this first sentence that he has said. And he has used a derivative of Vasca's complex. This is Vasca's complex. It's a derivative of Vasca's complex. Okay, where iridium is an iridium 1 oxidation state. It is capable of converting dimethyl acetylene to hexamethyl benzene. This is nothing but Me6 hexamethyl benzene at 110 degrees. What they have shown is that several of the intermediates in this case, these are all classic reaction mechanism papers where they have thoroughly understood the steps involved. So the first step is, in fact, a loss of ligand. In this case, it's not very difficult to see which ligand would be lost. L is PPH3. And N2 is a weak ligand. We have already discussed why N2 is a poor ligand. So N2 is a ligand which would be displaced, and it would react with dimethyl acetylene at room temperature. This reaction happens at 110 degrees, the cyclization reaction. So at room temperature, you can isolate the intermediate which is formed by the dimethyl acetylene and the iridium 1 species. And that can react with more dimethyl acetylene to give a second complex, which seems to be the catalytically active intermediate. The second complex is the iridium metallocyclopentadiene species that they are talking about. So I will give you the details in the next slide. What is interesting is that covered this. Okay, it doesn't matter. So this is the same species that we are talking about. Please ignore the numbers because I have copied it from the paper directly. So this is the species which is present from two different papers, so the numbers are different. So here is the nitrogen complex that we talked about. The loss of that gives you an intermediate which is stable at room temperature. The first step is just loss of that. Reaction with additional acetylene gives you the iridometallocyclopentadiene. I'm calling it irida because iridium is the metal here, and that gives you the metallocyclopentadiene. What they have mentioned in the paper is that this species can be very readily generated using Vasca's complex. So that's why I kept talking about Vasca's complex. Vasca's complex plus furfuryl azide. Furfuroic acid is the acid which is converted to the azide, and that's this species. I will show you in a minute how that works. It's basically a displacement reaction of the carbon monoxide is replaced first by the azide. The laws of nitrogen will lead to, the laws of the furfuroyl NCO, furyl NCO, okay, furyl NCO gives you the intermediate. That is the intermediate, that would be the intermediate which would just be iridium chloride vacant site LL, okay. So just to generate that, or just to generate that N2, you can generate it from N2 directly, or you can generate it in this fashion from Vasca's complex, okay. Then that gives you this catalytically active intermediate. This is a catalytically active intermediate. You can trap it with CO and then characterize it. You can characterize, you can trap it with other phosphines. Here is another example where a phosphine has been used for trapping. So phosphines and CO can trap these intermediates, and you can characterize them. 13 and 14 are characterized. Same thing with 8. 8 is also characterized. So here is the details of how the furfuroyl azide works. It is a simple displacement reaction because the CoN3, this molecule has got two points of attachment. So it displaces carbon monoxide. This is basically, it must be an equilibrium reaction where, because of the two points of attachment, the CO is pushed out and you have an intermediate like this. This intermediate loses dinitrogen, loses dinitrogen to the metal, and it loses PARNCO, this moiety. Let's draw it, let's draw out that so that it's clear. This species, I keep saying it's loss of N2. It's not loss of N2 because N2 is retained in the coordination sphere of the metal, and it is NCO which is lost. And this NCO reacts with ethanol, which is a solvent, and forms the species. But now we have the intermediate necessary for the catalytic reaction. So the catalytic cycle that we are talking about really involves the irida metallocyclopentadiene. In this particular case, I kept telling you that I have some negative evidence. The Diels-Alder adduct does not work. Okay, the Diels-Alder adduct does not work. He explains that in the paper. So it must be going through a metallocycloheptatriene, but that is only a moot point. The end result is that you can form at 110 degrees cyclization of three acetylenes to arene is very efficient. Okay, very efficient. And what we end up with is a species which is something like this. This can, in fact, dimerize to give you this intermediate. They acknowledge that, but the reaction is happening at 110 degrees. So this is probably reversible, and this can go back to this species in the presence of acetylene. Okay. So this is the reaction cycle that seems to be the case. Because I have explained most of the factors, I'm not going to go through this. These are all statements that go to prove whatever we have said in the previous slide. Okay, you can block the reaction with CO. It doesn't undergo Diels-Alder reaction, and what else did we talk about? Okay, the Iida cycle is formed even at ambient temperatures. That's the formation of the metallocyclopentadiene. So these are all steps which allowed them to zero in on the mechanism which I have shown in the previous slide. Okay, so what we have shown is that oxidative coupling can result in alkyne trimerization. Insertion reactions can also happen in trimerization reactions. Now, I briefly told you that nickel is capable of combining four alkynes to cyclooctatetraene. So the question is, what is nickel doing? Because nickel is capable in plus two oxidation state, it's capable of making cyclooctatetraene. In zero oxidation state, nickel is capable of making benzenes also. Nickel is not the best catalyst. Cobalt is the best catalyst, but nickel is capable of making benzene. But it seems to be oxidation state dependent. So what is the mechanism by which nickel does the coupling reaction? Okay, so it's still a mystery. Part of the mystery has been unraveled. And I will tell you the part that has been unraveled. This was actually unraveled in 1984. It's been a while since it was unraveled, but no intermediate has been isolated in the case of nickel 2 plus. So this is a reaction that has been, that is still a mystery. Not every step is known, but amazingly, I think cyclooctatetraene is produced in bulk quantity using this procedure even today. So it's not an easy molecule to make. The only thing that has been unraveled is to figure out what intermediates are not involved. Let me emphasize again. In most reaction mechanism studies, what you end up with is proposing multiple reaction pathways. And after proposing multiple pathways, you then rule out the most unlikely pathways based on precedence. And then you do experiments to find out whether the likely pathways, which one is the best. And in this case, this is what they did. For some of these steps, we have not looked at suitable, we have not explained all these steps, but we have explained a couple of them. Intermediacy of cyclobutadiene, we have already looked at some examples where cyclobutadiene are there. We have looked at some examples where metallocycloheptatrienes are there. Those are also valenced autotomers of the benzene complex, so we can write it like topologically they are identical. Another way is to think of nickel being bound to four acetylene molecules and just stitching of these four acetylene molecules. We'll call this the zipper mechanism. We'll call this the arene mechanism, and this is the cyclobutadiene mechanism. The carbine exchange pathway is something that we have not looked at, but in some instances it has been shown that a metal attached to an alkyne can break the triple bond and form CR. So it looks as if there is a possibility of breaking it like this. That's what I have written here. And the rest of the steps are not clear, but can the acetylene be broken down to a species like this and subsequently stitched together? So this is a very complicated mechanism. I want your full attention for the next 10 minutes. You will find it difficult to follow it otherwise. So the experiment that was done was, that was in 1981. That it was published. The mechanism was discovered by doing a reaction with a singly labeled acetylene molecule. Okay, this reaction works only with acetylene, by the way, no substituent. Cyclooctatetraene is completely unsubstituted, so it doesn't work with other substituents. So what they did was they labeled acetylene to make C triple bond C, where one is 13, another is 12. Okay, so that's what they did. And then they worked out the probability of various cyclooctatetraene molecules that can be made with the positions of the label differing if they went through different mechanisms. So here are the different mechanisms. So the zipper mechanism, for example, can go through a species like this. There are multiple probabilities. You can also do the zipper with another instance where, let me write one out for the sake of clarity. So here we have written it as head to tail. If this is the head, this is the tail. Carbon 12 is a tail. It's always head to tail. Okay, this is head to tail. We can also have head to head. So in other words, you can couple it like this, and then you will end up with cyclooctatetraene, which has got labels in these positions only. So this gives you this. This will give you alternating carbons with a label. So there are other possibilities where you can have a mixture of head to tail and head to head, and that will give you different cyclooctadienes. So you have to write out all the probabilities, and because this label is C13 versus C12, everything is equally probable. So you would write out the various cyclooctatetraenes that you would get. Similarly, cyclobutadiene, you can write different labels, but the dimerization takes place only through the double bonds combining with double bonds. So in other words, if I have intermediates like this, then what is the type of cyclooctadienes, tetraenes you will get? Random exchange is when you have carbines. Metal or benzenes can be like this. So if you write out the various probabilities, I have done it in this slide. You can go through it patiently. This is purely a test of writing out the various intermediates involved. So It may not be possible for you to do it in a test, but I want you to know this principle that if I have isotopic labeling, I can work out the position of the label as I go through different intermediates. And if the topological pathways are different, if the topological pathways are different, then I will end up with different ratios of differently labeled products. Okay, so here is the final result. If I have random breaking of acetylene moieties into carbines, if I have random breaking, then I will get equal amounts of 12.5% of acid label in every position. Okay, so if I have the zipper mechanism, I will not end up, when I start with this starting material, if I use only singly labeled acetylene, I cannot get this with the zipper mechanism. Okay, so these three cyclooctatetraenes are prohibited purely topologically. I cannot get them if I don't break the connectivity of the two carbons. Okay, if it is always a double bond, I will not be able to break it. So I will get only these products. So as a result, this is also not formed. As a result, I can distinguish if I can measure this different ratios of these compounds, I will be able to distinguish between these pathways. That's what the researchers did. They could not analyze cyclooctatetraene, so they converted it into, using the same Diels-Alder reaction, they converted it into the phthalate derivative, and the phthalate derivative was analyzed. And the phthalate derivative was analyzed for the theoretical distribution by looking at the various compounds that were formed in the dimethyl phthalate. And sure enough, they found out that the experiment fit the zipper mechanism the best. Okay. So as I told you, multiple mechanisms are possible. So the best fit was to the zipper mechanism. That doesn't mean that the product are not formed through other mechanisms. But most of the product must be formed through the zipper mechanism. Okay. So this was what they did. And I hope you have appreciated the fact that it is far from being a closed chapter. There are multiple pathways by which I can stitch acetylenes together, and different metals do it differently. And most of the lecture today is coming from older papers, but this is still an active area of interest. I'm going to tell you this 2018 paper, this is by Zhang. I think they pronounce it differently, but it doesn't matter. Zhang is the author of a paper who has looked at cyclization reactions of acetylenes. And there are two papers, one on titanium and one on palladium. Both of them talk about metallocyclo pentadiene intermediates. So with this, I'm going to stop today's lecture, and let me ask you if you have any questions. Especially the last part is something that you need to go back and take a look at the various intermediates and see if you can understand them. Simpler reactions can be solved using isotopic labeling. This is, I agree that this is a very complicated example, but nevertheless a beautiful choice of method for determining which is the reaction path. Okay.
Excuse me, sir.
Two of you are asking questions, so first one. That's why if you put up your hand, then you can. But doesn't matter. Okay, both of you. Pankaj, you go first. After that, Shubham.
Okay, sir. My question was, is there any generalization done? Which metals do cyclization via coupling and which metals prefer insertion reactions?
No, it's not really metal dependent because there are two factors. Metal is there, the ancillary ligand is there. So I have told you those two examples I have taken, and I have shown you that different pathways are possible. And nickel is still a mystery, I told you, because it's not very clear how nickel works.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
So the quick answer is it's not metal alone that matters. The oxidative addition versus insertion, both of them are capable of doing cyclization reactions. Shubham doesn't want to ask a question now. So, Anantu? Shubham, you again?
Yeah, my headphone disconnected, sorry. Sir, I was asking, in the random exchange, how do we have a nickel with like many electrons. There are too many electrons around the nickel for the carbine breakage that we have, carbine intermediate that we have shown. Isn't that so, sir?
I'm not able to follow. If you have a slight number or something, or which one you're talking about, nickel or cobalt or?
So for this last reaction, we have shown the random pathway, right? Where we started.
Yeah. You're wondering about this intermediates that I have written.
Yes.
The intermediates that I have written here.
This one.
These are just topological to explain the difference. You have written it out like that. You don't need an intermediate exactly in this fashion. Okay.
So also, how do we know for the zipper reaction, this direct head-tail combination could flip around and give us the second compound as well, right? How do we know that this mechanism doesn't flip?
Okay, what we mean by a zipper mechanism here is that at no point in time, the connectivity between the two acetylenes are lost. Okay, so let me, I did not have time to explain this, but cyclobutadiene, for example. Okay, so this is the cyclobutadiene. It can interchange with this cyclobutadiene. Okay, so as a result, if I have a reaction which goes through a double bond, so dimerization involves double bonds. So now the breakage will involve these two bonds in this tautomer. In this valence tautomer, this bond will be broken. So it's really the intermediacy of a cyclobutadiene purely means that the breaking of a species where the two are now connected through a single bond or a double bond, and whether that connectivity between the two labels are lost. So here in this example, the connectivity between the C12 and the C13 is not lost, it's retained throughout. In cyclobutadiene, it is lost because of interchange like this. Same thing with benzene, it will be lost because you will have valence tautomers that interconvert these two forms of hexatriene. So the reaction will happen through a hexatriene intermediate. Okay, because if it has to do a Diels-Alder reaction and react, so it'll break these two bonds. This will have to form a react. Okay, so that is the kind of mechanism they're talking about. Okay. What was Anantu? Anantu.
Excuse me, sir. Sir, just like with the case of palladium catalyzed reaction, does the cobalt catalyzed reaction also have a dependence on the bulkiness of R groups on the end product we end up with?
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah, it does. Here in this slide, steric difference between methyl and ethyl is sufficient to retard the trimerization. So everywhere, if I have a bulky group, then the reaction is stopped.
All right. Yes.
So that seems to be a common factor in both insertion reaction and oxidative coupling reaction.
Sir, in the case of oxidative coupling reactions, is it because of the energy barrier required to get the sterically crowded acetylenes together? Like first it has to form a metallocyclopentane.
Yeah, in both cases it is the steric factor is the for the coupling to happen, for the insertion, second insertion to happen, bulky groups have to come together. So yes, bulky groups have to come together whether you do a coupling or an insertion. The second step is
yes, sir. In the insertion reactions, it basically depends on the whole steric crowding around the metal, right? But in the case of oxidative coupling reactions, for the two acetylene bonds to come together to form a metallocyclopentadiene, that is the rate determining step, right, sir?
The rate determining step is probably that, but then ultimately the R groups are there on the acetylene only. No, so whether you have to bring those two groups close by, and that is preventing the next step.
Yes.
So I don't know whether you can really distinguish. I think the reason why you're asking this question is because you want to say steric effects are more important in one mechanism than in the other. I am trying to understood from the way in which you asked the question. And the answer is, in both cases, steric factors are deterring the second and the third step. The first step where the metal just coordinates happens easily. The second step where the coupling happens, where the insertion happens, seems to be deterred by steric factors in both cases.
Okay, sir. That answers my question.
Yeah, and that is not too difficult to understand because you have the R group is present on the acetylene and that is present in both cases. Okay, so I think we have to stop here. Okay, if you we can continue conversation on the Teams, I will stop the recording at this point, right? And we'll meet on Monday.